Well, it's really nice to see a fairly full house. I have to say, I'm a little bit surprised. I kind of thought this might be one of those talks where you come and there's like five people, you know, when you try to work it up. But anyway, so I really appreciate that you're here. I'd like to know a little bit about my audience. How many of you are undergraduates? How many of you are undergraduates in the field of psychology? How about in the field of child development? There were some, you know, no hands raised. Like, what's your area of interest? Did I see over here? You too? I'm pointing at you too. Are you in psychology?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
What other disciplines are out there?
I'm a graduate student.
Oh, you're a graduate student. And what have you studied?
I'm studying neuroscience.
Okay. All right. There's a bit of a link between neuroscience and working with kids in the schools. There's a lot of neurological functioning that supports or inhibits kids' learning for sure. So I was introduced as a practicing school psychologist. I will admit that I've been in the field for almost 30 years, and I have, as often happens when one gains more and more expertise, move further away from the direct service with children, and I'm now a special education director in a local school district. The benefit of that is that I do have a lot of say over programming. And as such, I think that you will find the work that's being done in our district through Clara Gina, who is the school psychologist for the district, is cutting edge and really appropriate for our local population. I'll let her talk about that more when we get to it. But what I want to just talk about is, what is a school psychologist? A guide for undergraduate students. All of you are undergraduate, mostly. This comes from the National Association of School Psychologists. This is an association that started up long after I got into the field, actually, but it's a growing field. And even though there's been statewide associations for school psychologists, at one point there became the National Association for School Psychologists, recognizing the need to come together across states and link up practices, despite perhaps different guidelines or even laws within specific states around working with children in schools. And it's become a very powerful and supportive association on many levels, legislatively, which is really important in this day and age, and also just in terms of research and providing state-of-the-art evidence-based intervention practices that support children in their learning, whether it's to address neurological deficits or social-emotional behavioral challenges. So it's really become a very good organization for us. And as a result, they have, for people like yourselves who may be interested in the field of school psychology, a slideshow that I'm going to share with you. I hope. There it goes. So what is the role of a school psychologist? There are many different things that a school psychologist does, and essentially what is outlined by MASP and by the California Association of School Psychologists and the California Commission on Teacher Credentialing, which is what ultimately gives you the right to work as a school psychologist, there are certain domains of practice. And within those domains are these broad categories of assessment, consultation, prevention, intervention, staff, parent, and student education, research and program development, mental health care, advocacy, and systems change. The thing I can say about school psychology is it's a dynamic field. It's never boring. You go into work and you have your list of to-dos, and if you get through two of them, you're fortunate. It's very dynamic. You're working with families, children, teachers, administrators, community agencies, and so forth. It's also a field where you can really specialize. You can be broad in your orientation, or you can specialize in specific areas, such as working with children with mental health issues, or working with children with autism, or getting into more of an administrative role like I'm in right now, or conducting research and working in the schools at that level. So it's a really dynamic and growing field. I think the flyer for this talk said that it's the number one, according to U.S. News, job in the the field of social services, and it is growing. It's a dynamic area. So why do we even have school psychologists? How many of you actually know that you had a school psychologist when you were going through the K-12 system in your district? 1, 2, 3, 4. Yeah, so like, how many is that? That's like a fifth of you at the most, right? It's not, we're kind of behind the scenes. We're change agents behind the scenes. So we're not front and center. And in part, that's because we have such a specialized role that we play within the education system to support children. So we're not front and center like teachers are, or like the principal is, or even like the school counselor might be. Although that said, many school psychologists are school counselors. That's another track you can take, and is also a very dynamic and diverse profession. So school psychologists address issues related to learning difficulties, behavioral concerns, attention problems, problems at home or with peers, fears about war, violence, terrorism, depression, other mental health issues, coping with crisis and trauma, poverty, violence, life-changing events, advocacy of their learning and mental health needs. The poverty, violence, or life-changing events, Claire will talk about this more. In this county, we do have what's called students with what are called high ACE, A-C-E scores. Have any of you heard of that term before? It's adverse childhood experiences. And there are ways to score the degree to which a child has experienced adverse conditions. And there's specific neurological functioning that develops with children who have these experiences in their infancy, toddlerhood, early years, to where they learn and interact with their environment differently. So this is a very cutting edge area of research right now, and coming out of that are some really interesting practices to support children with learning. So within this school here, within HSU and our program, and the fact that you're put out into districts conducting field work, you get a lot of training in working with children in this realm of society. When should teachers collaborate with school psychologists? Well, typically what happens is that there's a challenging academic or behavioral situation, and we are requested to come in and do observations and collaborate and consult and assist with creating solutions to clearly defined problems. We support with implementing effective individualized instruction. We provide evidence-based practices and interventions in accordance with laws to address students' learning needs. We evaluate student progress toward individual goals and state standards. And we advocate for resources within the school and community for all students and their families. The part about evaluating student progress toward individual goals, that can be related to any sort of academic learning, social learning, behavioral learning, emotional learning, fine motor learning, any number of things. And monitoring the progress of student achievement is in any one of those areas is really critical to supporting kids. So there's a lot of assessment. Many of you may have thought, you think school psychologist, and maybe what comes up is the idea of psychometrist. That isn't what a school psychologist is. Again, there's these umbrella domains of practice that cover everything from consultation, collaboration, to home, school, community networking, to assessment practices, to mental health interventions, and so on, research, etc. That said, assessment is often a part of what's going on, because even if you're consulting and collaborating, you're checking out the environment, you're doing observations, you're assessing interpersonal dynamics. There's a lot going on in the field of assessment that's beyond that standardized formal assessment practice that many of you probably have heard about, such as cognitive assessment, social-emotional assessment, academic assessment that's formal and standardized. By the way, I'm sitting here yapping at you. I'm really good at that. So if you have a question, just raise your hand. I'd love to be interrupted. I'd love to have some dialogue going on. So if anything comes up as I'm going along and you have a question about something specifically, don't hesitate. Raise your hand and I'll call on you. Okay, so to conduct assessments, this is a very short list. There's observations, interviews, standardized measures, curriculum-based measurement, curriculum-based assessment, and so forth. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on that. School psychologists evaluate the origin and degree of a student's strengths and weaknesses and monitor progress toward reaching academic goals. Now, the term weaknesses, we're getting better at using our terminology. I prefer the term challenges. I prefer, you maybe have heard of things like a specific learning disability. That's still in the law. That is still the eligibility title. I prefer difference, learning difference. So slowly we're starting to make some changes with language, which we all know is very powerful. And even though the law hasn't caught up, hopefully one day it will. We do child-centered consultations. One of the things I think is the most important in the work that I do, and I suspect you would agree, is that we are advocates, first and foremost, for children. So we're often up against a large system, and as you all know, systems have their bureaucracy and their methodologies and their boundaries and so forth. But it is our job, from my perspective, to advocate for children who don't necessarily fit neatly into that square peg and who need some support with having a positive school experience. Bottom line, that is my job, supporting children having a positive school experience. When I work with teachers, and I'm sure Claire does the same thing. This is what we teach at HSU. When we work with teachers and administrators and to a large degree with children and say agency people, so forth, we use what's called a consultee approach to our consultation, meaning that we don't swoop in and say, I have the answer to your problems. We swoop in and say, let's define what the problems are. Let's talk about what you need to see happen, what would be your ideal situation. Let's talk about how we can make that occur. What are the best avenues for doing that? Let's talk about what I can do to support that. So we have a certain amount of expertise that we bring to the table, but our goal is to support people in owning their agenda, essentially, and their lives, and thinking creatively about how to move successfully in their lives, whether it's a teacher or a child getting his way through school, or a parent who's struggling with parenting skills, and so forth. So school psychologists and teachers collaborate when presented with challenging students, classrooms, or situations. And basically there's a process that we use. It's called a student success team process, where we meet together as a group of professionals and we look at what the strengths are that a child has and how we can draw on those to address challenges. We come up with intervention methodologies. We determine who's going to do those interventions. We monitor the progress. We come back at a later date and look at the data. Has progress been made? If it has, keep doing it. If it hasn't, turn a corner, right? So that's essentially how we work together. We do a lot of prevention. There are a lot of programs that we can implement. I'll just give you an example of something in my history. There was a period where the California Department of Mental Health was really promoting what they called primary intervention in the schools. And I wrote a grant, and over the course of 10 years, I obtained $30,000, which back in those days was a lot of money. And I was able to hire people like yourselves and conduct training to do what we would call non-directive play techniques. So you're not being a non-directive play therapist, which many of you have probably heard of that sort of professional title, but you would learn these non-directive play techniques because it had been proven that for children who are in what was considered a moderate risk of not doing well in school, when given these play techniques, being in a environment where there's toys and they could do their non-directive play activity under the support of a special friend, they improved in their participation, their feelings of confidence about school, their attendance improved. So these are kids who are, you know, kind of missing school or asking to go to see the nurse quite a bit. It definitely wasn't an appropriate sort of program for higher stakes children who really exhibited pretty significant emotional and behavioral disorders. But for those 5-year-olds to 8-year-olds who were just not quite doing well in school, it was fabulous. And these interventions would occur weekly for 14 weeks, and we could just see the progress over time. As often occurs, that funding source dried up. So after 10 years of doing that, I wasn't able to do it anymore. We did try to keep it going, and we did at a half level in my district from what was occurring, but then again, over time, I've been around it long enough that I've seen the pendulum do this, and I do fear that it might be going in a different direction in the near future. But there was points when we were fat with money, and then points when we were really thin. So that one got lost. That said, when Claire is going to talk, she'll talk about a grant that she just received that is going to address some really critical needs within the school district and around the county. So again, we design programs, we implement programs, we get money, we do what we can to advocate for kids so that they have a good experience, so that they can have a safe, supportive learning environment within which to learn, and again, fostering tolerance and appreciation of diversity. And that too is something that is so much more front and center in the world in general now, certainly, and in school systems, that social justice has a place in the school system, and respecting diversity and promoting tolerance and so forth is critical. Those are critical components that need to be conducted in the schools, and school psychologists play a very key role in that process. Teachers know their students best, so teachers can help school psychologists with prevention efforts by identifying students at risk and systemic concerns in the classroom, school, and community. The point of this slide is to say that your teachers are key. If you think back on your career as a K-12 student, I bet each of you could identify one teacher, if not more, or one person in the school system, but often it's a teacher, who made a difference in your life, who had some sort of impact. So teachers are very powerful. Therefore, it's important to work with teachers, support them in doing their best work to implementing best educational practices for kids. And like everybody, we get tired. And so often the role of a school psychologist is just to be that sounding board, to allow teachers to vent, and then to come around full circle to being reminded that, oh my gosh, I really do love this profession and I can do it. And it's, again, through that consultee-centered approach for supporting them. There's intervention practices. You know, we do parent education. We do, like I was telling you, the primary intervention program directly with kids. We have specific academic intervention practices. All of it is evidence-based, meaning that there's research behind it, and that's what drives the intervention. School psychologists can help teachers select, implement, and evaluate interventions. So one of the things that school psychologists have in their tool belt of skills is research knowledge. So not, you know, many teachers have that as well, but it's not as large of an emphasis because they're being asked to teach kids to read, write, do arithmetic, and then as they get through education to learn specific standards that are set forth by the state. So they don't have a whole lot of time to do the research necessary to determine if the specific methodology of teaching they're using is effective or not. So again, school psychologists come in at that level to help with that process. Nowadays, everything is data-driven, and that's fine, because that means we're going to be implementing best practices, as long as we look at the data and then respond to it appropriately. So again, there's training for teachers and parents. You know, you can read through that.
If you're making notes, you might want to put down the website, massonline.org, and you can research all you want on school psychologists.
What is the website?
NASP, N-A-S-P, National Association for School Psychologists, online.org.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then there's CASP also.
Do you have to have a login for that?
Well, they can view quite a bit without the login.
Okay.
And then there's also the California Association of School Psychologists.
Right.
That's also CASPonline.org, so you can look at that one as well.
And if you're interested in careers, I recommend that you also go on what's called EdJoin. And have you heard of EdJoin? E-D-J-O-I-N. And basically, it's a web-based mechanism that school districts in the United States, but particularly in California, have job postings. And you could just put in any region that you want and type in school psychologist and see what pops up. I think you'd be surprised at how many of them there are and what the pay range is. It's solid and it's good. Again, we talked about research and program development as being part of the practice of school psychology and part of what occurs in schools. And, you know, talked about database decision making as a key component to the work we do. Everything is data driven, as it should be. One of the components to that, though, as you all know, or those of you who have conducted research, is that you have to determine whether the program's been implemented with fidelity. So there's always that side of it. When you're working with human beings, there's always a lot of, you know, wobbliness in certain administration of certain practices. So one of the things we do is fidelity checks, and then if something isn't being implemented with fidelity, then we support that it does get implemented with fidelity. Again, it's always to support student learning and success and the ability to navigate the school system comfortably. So mental health services. We do a lot of mental health services in the schools. We're a kind face for many students to come to. Like I said, we're advocates. We're not doing discipline. That doesn't mean that we're not teaching kids the rules of respect, responsibility, citizenship, etc. We are doing that. But if a problem comes up that requires discipline, I exit. I don't want to have that role. There are other people for that role. But I will support them in what could be done differently later and what skill deficits are there that need to be learned so that discipline doesn't have to occur. That's a strong role that I would have to play, as does Claire. I thought I almost saw a hand raise. I was getting excited there.
Oh, there's one. Is that because you want a more neutral approach than you work with the students?
Good question. You know, rapport building is so critical to the work we do. And as you know, with children, but with everybody, there's a ratio of the magic ratio is 5 to 1, 5 positives, and then you can do a correction. So if I'm working with a child, I want to really keep that ratio high on the positive side. And if a correction has to occur, it's going to be around supporting in a skill deficit. If it's got to be a big correction, I want someone like the vice principal or the principal to do that, because that's an obvious role for them. They have to uphold a certain level of safety, and they have to follow legal policy and board policy and so forth. So it's mostly about maintaining a rapport.
Okay. I think also the students will be on guard if they don't know that you are, you know, with them, supporting them. So I always tell them pretty much in the very beginning of establishing a relationship that they are never in trouble with me, and my job is to help them stay out of trouble.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we try to emphasize the non-conditional, positive, utmost regard type approach. And that's a really, that is a real positive aspect to the job. The reality is we do a lot of work and we don't see immediate results. That's true. You know, sometimes I go home and mow the lawn because it feels so good to see something happen immediately. And it's like, oh, did something today. Because when you're, again, when you're working with children who have challenges, you know, they don't just learn those skills immediately and improve. It takes some time. But just knowing that they'll come see you because they trust you and they know that walking through your door is going to be a safe place is very rewarding. So there's that side of it. Yes. Oh, another question.
You said
have I recruited you yet?
No. Maybe. No. Just kidding. You talk about being a school psychologist within a district, but then you say them coming through your door. So my understanding was there's usually a school, maybe school psychologist, maybe one or two assigned per district. So you're not actually housed within the school. You may have an office in the school that you stop into. So how does that work?
Yeah, it varies from district to district. So Humboldt County is really unique because there's a bunch of small districts. Okay. And very odd for considering how few people live in Humboldt County. So as a result, we actually do have offices that we go to and we pretty much are in. In a larger district, it's more like what you're talking about, where you've got the mobile school psychologist whose office is in the trunk of her car. That said, there's typically a schedule, so maybe then the child does have to wait until Tuesday. Mm-hmm. They're not going to be able to see you on Wednesday, and if a problem arises, then they're going to have to wait until Tuesday. There's also some benefit to that, though, where we can teach children strategies for being able to delay whatever it is that they're needing to address, and sometimes they even resolve the problem themselves in between that time. We're pretty lucky in our district because we are on campus, on site for hunks of time. So, and that is kind of rare. Good question. Yes.
Is there a difference between a private and public school psychologist, or are there even school psychologists for private schools?
If a private school wants to hire a school psychologist, then they do. Yeah, right. Charter schools would be somewhat similar, but they are public schools, so they have to uphold the same federal mandates and state mandates that all public schools uphold. So they will definitely have a school psychologist at some point, maybe more like what Maria was talking about, just dropping in occasionally, depending on the size of the school. But no, private is private, so it's not public. So unless a private school, so they don't have access, at least at this point in time.
Have you heard differences in experiences between working in the two?
Between private and public?
Yeah, do you know anyone?
Yeah, I know people who have worked, say, for like a Catholic school or a Christian school. Those are private. No, kids are kids, you know. They have their issues. And yeah.
Well, I didn't know if there's more regulations or like.
No, not really. You know, I mean, within a private school, they might have. They're still trying to uphold Common Core standards and do all of the things that a public school does. But the difference typically is that they're going to be smaller class sizes, which is nice, and you might be able to do more sort of programming within classrooms, maybe. Yes.
Uh-huh. So for charter schools and a school psychologist, how come there's just a drop-in, like, not like maybe once a week or once a month? Is it just because of funding?
Yeah. I mean, I shouldn't say that. I think there's probably some charter schools out there that actually hire someone to be there maybe even 2 days a week or two and a half days.
She goes to a charter school and it's really hard to get it. Psychologist there, and a lot of the children are low income, low poverty, so it was beneficial for them to have one, but because of funding, they can't.
Right. Yeah, that's the issue, funding for sure. I mean, we all have funding issues, but so then it comes down to a school board making those tough decisions and determining where does the money go. Maybe they have to take a little bit out of art and music and put it here. So that's common across all school systems for sure. Yes.
Do you have experience with PROs with conduct disorder? And if so, do you have specific treatment plans for such kids?
Big question. Yes and yes.
Those are the fun ones.
Yeah, right. You know, conduct disorder is a really difficult condition to address effectively. There's a distinction between what's considered social maladjustment and emotional disturbance, with the idea that conduct disorder has more of a social maladjustment component and more of a control and willful intent behind it, and emotional disturbance has...
Manipulative.
That is the distinction. Now, when you're in schools, I really can't make that distinction, because if a child's not able to make friends or isn't able to navigate the school system or isn't able to access curriculum, and maybe it's because they are a conduct disorder, I still need to provide services and attempt to assist that child in functioning better within the system. The research doesn't have great prognosis for interventions for social maladjustment, much greater prognosis for children who are identified as emotionally disturbed. Then the distinction there being that that is more associated typically with a mental illness, and then you have a variety of things. Yeah, there's medication supports, there's intervention supports, and so, and the response, there's the underlying sort of true nature of the child is to want to blend and make friends and succeed. Whereas with conduct disorder, it's not always that clear. So yes, I have had that experience, and I'll be honest with you, prognosis for improvement is low, and that's been my experience with it. I hate to say that, but yeah. But not impossible.
Because I know they're not concerned with performance a lot of the time.
Because they're not what's
concerned with, like, performance, like improvements.
You mean the conduct disorder child isn't? Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. Oftentimes,
tend to
it, yeah, their intentions aren't. They're not perhaps as hooked into society in the same way, mm-hmm. and don't have the same needs for approval, and as what occurs for typically developing people.
Thank right? you.
Yeah. Okay. Hope that. Yeah. That's like almost an entire class discussion, like a 3-hour class discussion. Okay, but that's kind of the short answer. So anyway, there's a lot of advocacy that happens within the National Association of School Psychologists and California Association of School Psychologists. And believe me, now with current changes that have occurred at the federal level, there's going to be a lot of activity in this realm, because we really need to hang on to what we can to support children in public education with getting the best education they can. So this is also another area that one can go into as a school psychologist or a teacher. Anybody can go into advocacy work. And because we all work together to advocate for the needs of students at the school, local, state, and national level. Advocates. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Claire. Thank you very much for listening, and thank you for asking some questions. Okay, let's get over this way. Do I need to find your PowerPoint now?
Yeah, if you could.
Okay, so what I want to do is shut this off so I don't show my whole email thing. How can I do that? Isn't there a way to?
Yes, there is.
Okay. And so you can go ahead and like introduce some of the things.
I love this job. I love everything about this job. The hardest thing is balancing self-care and this job, because you really could do so much. So learning those boundaries is really important. It is delightful to work with children, to collaborate with a team, have everyone come together and put forth really good plans for children and really good interventions and have them work. It can be a long struggle to get there, but when it happens, it's phenomenal. So it's a very rewarding career. The program here at HSU, and I'm sure other school psych programs too, but this is the one that I know, is really rich in that you have a lot of time in schools working with a supervising school psychologist to teach you the ropes. So you get to take that theory out into practice and really have those awesome hands-on experiences. a day, I always have a plan for my day, and I know that it's never going to go according to plan, but I have that plan. So we're very flexible. You know, we shift things around and we prioritize, and you are truly never bored, as Lisa said. It's a job that there's always something more to learn, something more to develop, so it's just making sure you get your sleep and your eat and your time with your family too. And, you know, be patient with your learning, because it's a job that really to get up and running takes a while, but you're learning every year and you're getting more efficient and better. So I usually start my day off with, well, first with some self-care, so I do some meditation, I spend a little time reading. Sometimes I do some exercise or I walk the dog, and then I head to work, because I find for me that doing that morning, first thing, is very helpful to setting the tone for my entire day. When I come in, oftentimes there are kids to greet me, and often they'll pop in with me while I'm getting set up for the day, and I'll just hang out at my office and play with the sand tray. Often they'll want to see me more than I can see them, so that's kind of hard to say no, but we only have so many hours in the day, so I try to make sure that I connect with them on some level. You have things that bubble up that need attention right away. We conduct risk assessments at times for children who might be making a suicidal statement. Sometimes it's just talk, sometimes it really is a serious situation that we have to help them develop a safety plan and be sure that the whole team, their parents and everyone are on board to support them, and then also move in the direction of getting them the services that they need. I'm really privileged to be in the district that I'm in, because I don't just do assessment. I also get to do intervention with students. I love working with children with autism and helping them learn how to interact socially, to help develop their theory of mind skills. And I think part of the reason why I really love that is that there are some really great resources out there to learn how to do that. It's not easy, it takes a long time, but there's great research out there to support the practice. And I really love, you know, working with all kids. Typically, if I'm have a student who's having depression or anxiety, and it's within the realm of my practice as a school psychologist, if it's, I'll do cognitive behavioral therapy with them, because really everything I do is teaching them skills, and cognitive behavioral therapy is teaching skills. You know, you're learning to change your behavior or change your thinking, to change your feelings. And then if it's something that's more serious than that, I'm going to refer out to an outside mental health provider, because someone who's an MFT or an LCSW likely has the capacity to treat that much more than I do. I really keep mine related to school functioning. Like if there's a divorce with parents, unless I'm the only mental health provider available, I'm not going to treat that. I'm going to send it out elsewhere. In some of the really rural school districts, there might not be any MFTs or LCSWs around to treat those children. So you might be the only mental health provider. So you're kind of in a constant state also of partaking in professional development to continue to build your skill set. So you're always building your skill set. There is so much to learn. I do consultation with teachers to help them, to really help empower them. So I don't take their problem and fix it for them. I help them get the tools that they need. And some of the techniques that have worked really well for me, first of all, is reflective listening, to really hear them and not judge them. And then also to ask them questions. Just to tell me more is three words that are incredibly powerful for working with parents and teachers and students. I like doing the assessments. They take a long time. They're a lot of work. What I like about them is that you do the formal psychometric evaluations, but you do observations, and you do file reviews, and you talk to teachers, and you talk to parents, and you put everyone's report into one large report, and when it gels, you know you're good, and you know what interventions to suggest for the team to use with the student. Let's see, what I like about that is that the assessment gives you the data that drives your intervention, which promotes school success. So it's very wonderful and rewarding to work, keep saying that rewarding, that it is, to work with a collaborative team and develop those plans, you know, based on your, it's not just your assessment, it's everyone else's too, but you're putting it all together. What else can I say about that? I do supervision. I have usually have one child development student, sometimes two, who are undergrad who do their directed field placement with me, and that's super helpful because they come in and they're confidential. They can help do observations. They can go out and scaffold play on the playground for children, and then that's also another way for me to be kind of sharing the knowledge that I've learned from other people. To kind of spread it out, and I also do supervision for, this is the first year I'm supervising an intern, and then also HSU school psych students, and I really love that part of it. I have a nice balance now where I still get to work directly with kids, but I also get to work with university students, you know, usually young adults, but I wasn't a young adult when I went through the program, so sometimes it's older people too. So that's really wonderful. It's a lot of scheduling, a lot of organization. I schedule a time to schedule every Sunday is my scheduling time. And then I know that it's gonna change. And I have a very long to-do list, and as Lisa said, if you get two things done, it's awesome. But you really learn to prioritize. So do you have any questions so far?
What age groups do you work with?
I am mainly at the third grade through fifth grade school. Although I also supervise the intern who's at the TK through second grade school. And then I do a few interventions and a few assessments at that school too for kind of maybe more challenging students or families. Ones that I really need to build rapport with to help keep that rapport going through all of the school years. So I saw a hand over here. Did you have a question?
How do you think your time's kind of split? Like, or for like, an average school psychologist even in this area, like in terms of like doing interventions for like IEPs for special needs, and then also being able to work with teachers and faculty, or being able to work individually with students, or even like do things like anti-bullying, you know, for instance, like that.
I think that jobs really vary depending on the district. This is a district that really values intervention. So I have time for intervention. And I plan my day so that I'm doing assessments in the morning typically, or consulting with administration or calling parents, working with the HSU school psych students. Usually in the mornings, then in the afternoon, I'm pulling kids for their regular weekly sessions because that's the time that's less academic. So I try to be thoughtful of that, but it's hard to say. There are school sites who only do assessments and testing. There are ones who only do behavior. There are ones who only do counseling. So it really varies depending on the job. So I like that mine's well-rounded.
Do you feel like you
get to work with teachers and staff at schools to interact and encourage interaction with children that are on the spectrum and children with special needs? Oh, yeah. That's a really important part of the job. That's what Lisa was talking about with the consultee center consultation. So I can either have a formal consultation practice, or I enter into a confidential relationship with a teacher, which means that I'm not going to share anything with admin or anybody else about what she says to me. And we're going to work together to try to help her find solutions. I know that I've done a really good job at consultation. If I've made a suggestion, because we're really planting seeds, we're not telling them what to do. We're planting ideas and then also providing supports if they want specific supports. But when someone comes back to you and says, I have this great idea, and you know that you talked with them about it last week, but they think it's their idea, it's like, then you know, you did a really good job of consultation. So
Claire, can I just make one comment?
Sure.
Towards your question, which is that, you know, even 10 years ago, I would say that the ratio between assessment practices and intervention consultation practices would be really high on the side of assessment. Now, the pace of the population within school districts has shifted, culture has shifted, the priorities have shifted, so I think it's becoming more equalized across school districts. And then that said, you can kind of pick and choose what you want to do. You can find the position that fits you. I couldn't have said that 10 years ago, but this is a growing field, and there are way more positions out there than there are people to fill them right now. So that's one of the things that you can think of as undergraduates considering a career move, that it is a position that will be available and that you could tailor to what your particular interests are. You know, so that's kind of a good thing.
Mental health funding has also come back to the school, so you know that's been helpful, and I think nationally, at least previously nationally, you know, we're still very focused on children's mental health. So
do you feel that the HSU school site grant program like really set you up to find a job in that field?
Absolutely.
She kind of has to say that.
I felt well prepared to come out into internship. You know, you have a supervisor in internship, but all of our coursework was really excellent. We had people in the community, like a licensed educational psychologist who taught us our cognitive assessment coursework. So we got a really nice, broad, good education. So yeah, I have
you
really
get a lot of experience and time
you
out.
Yeah, 3 semesters of practicum experience where you're out in a school for 2 days a week or such. Yeah. And then you get a year-long internship. Oh. So you really get to hone your skills. Yeah, it's excellent. Yes.
How important is it to assess the child and identify the disability to get services for that child? Is it more important just to work on intervention first and then assess the child, or?
There's a process with that.
I would say yes to the second one. I think, you know, frankly, in fact, I was just teaching class, and there are some districts in the country that do minimal assessment, that really focus on intervention. You can determine a child's difficulties through observation and observing the process of problem solving that they might use whenever they're conducting whatever academic tests they're doing. So. Definitely start with intervention support. So there's tier 1, tier 2, tier 3 it's called, right? So tier 2 would be that maybe you would have small groups, or you would support the teacher in conducting specific methodologies, speaking their class up, etc. So I would say start with that first before assessment.
Yeah, Lisa had talked about the student study team process. So there's, when a student is having difficulty, the teacher or someone can request that a student study team meet, and it could be behavior too, it doesn't just have to be academics. We meet as a team if they want my presence for some reason, like there's a mental health issue or a behavioral issue, they'll ask me to attend as well. And then we problem solve and we try interventions first and really try everything we can before we move on to assessment.
So even with intervention, can you still get special services, like maybe occupational therapy or something like that, needed?
Well, in order for the school to purchase it, that does need to be identified as a disabling condition that impedes learning. And then that is definitely a more formal process that leads to an IEP.
Are you going to talk about your
Bridges
Grant?
So through Humboldt County Mental Health, there is a program called Bridges, which is a large grant that they were given to parse out to different community entities who wanted to write for grants. And this was the last round of funding for the Bridges Grant. We submitted a grant to provide the teachers with professional development on trauma-informed service delivery. So we have a series of 4 trauma-informed presentations. The first one I'm going to do, because I too was a child development major, I've got a lot of passion for child development, and so that the first part of our professional development series is going to be teaching the teachers about child development through a series of videos and resources through things like the organizations like the Harvard Center for the Developing Child and some other organizations. So I'm kind of a guide for them through that. And then we have 2 more sessions where 2 women who are board certified behavioral analysts, and one of them has had, she's an MFT as well, she's had training in the neurosequential model for therapeutics, or we also have the neurosequential model for education. That's Dr. Bruce Perry's work. And she's well experienced, as is the other behaviorists. They're going to present 2 sessions on classroom-based interventions, because the teachers are asking, you know, they're saying, we understand about trauma, now what do you do?
And the key behind this and why it's so exciting is that Humboldt County does rank one or two in the state as per capita as having the highest number, either the first or the second highest, I can't remember which, number of children exposed to that ACE I was telling you, adverse childhood experiences. So this is a really important kind of program to support teachers in understanding how to effectively support children who have neurologically developed differently from what your typically developing child has experienced. It's just really critical.
Sorry.
I'm done.
Okay. So here's a little blurb about faces.
Adverse childhood experiences and toxic stress is a public health crisis because we now have the science to show us not only do traumatic experiences in childhood have an effect on one's emotional health and well-being, they also have an effect on one's physical health and well-being.
Do I think ACEs is a public health issue? It is the leading public health issue of our time.
Our mental health colleagues have been sounding the alarm on this for decades.
And Dr. Bob Ross, who is the CEO of the California Endowment, said something very, very, I think, poignant. And he said, childhood trauma is the number one public health crisis in the United States that is hidden in plain sight.
In order to accomplish this goal, no one place can do it alone. Partnerships are really critical, and it's not difficult to get partners when you're dealing with children who are facing the adversity that we know from the ACEs studies.
The fact is it crosses so many sectors, so it doesn't just affect health and medical health. It affects mental health, education, juvenile justice. It affects all of these different sectors, and when we can really draw those clear, bright lines, we can all work together. I'm very hopeful for that change.
We're basically understanding now at a scientific level is what Frederick Douglass told us a long time ago, and that is that it's easier to build strong children than to repair broken men.
I'm Jane Stevens. I'm founder and editor of ACEs Too High and ACEs Connection, and I'm inviting you to join the movement because health begins with hope.
So that Center for Youth Wellness is Nadine Burke Harrison's organization. Her nonprofit, and sorry, I am not technologically savvy. I'll just say that right now. That's not a requirement for being a school psychologist. So, anyway, she has a really wonderful TED Talks, and she talks about the health outcomes for people who've experienced early childhood adverse childhood experiences. And there's a correlation between the number of adverse childhood experiences you've had and the health outcomes. Reduce lifespan by 20 years, just to name, you know, one thing about it. So it's very interesting research. If you don't already know about it, I highly recommend that you look into it because this really is a paradigm shift in how we think about mental health and health in general.
And how we educate kids. It's happening. It's a movement right now. So it's pretty exciting. Claire's really humble. I just applaud her that she got this grant. She's bringing it to our school district. She's educating teachers. She's supporting them so that they can provide better environments and educational strategies to assist kids who have been exposed to adverse childhood experiences in having a better school experience. And I just love it. And I want to applaud her for that.